video of two Russians who were was the base jumping. He had the parachute on to begin with, so I'm thinking that was the ultimate goal.
I think so.
Was to do that, but it was a video of a guy who was ziplining between like two big mountains.
No,
he was, I don't know, 2,000 feet in the air, maybe more.
Yeah, maybe more.
And he was ziplining between these two mountains, and it looked like the clip that he was using to zipline with
was not a zipline.
Not
clip.
The right zipline. It wasn't the right clip for it, like the little carabiner thing, because it was screaming as he was sliding down that steel cable. Like the thing was hollering, and there's like all this dust coming off of it where it's tearing the cable up. Yeah. And he's panicking, and he's trying to figure out what to do, and he's, like, grabbing at the fucking cable.
Like, don't do that. It's going to make it worse.
And I'm just like, God, there's no fucking telling how hot that clip got, like, from all that friction.
Well, I don't understand, because he had gloves on, and then he took the gloves off. Like, why would you take the gloves off?
I don't know.
I guess he was, like, panicking, and, like, in his panic, he took the gloves off for some reason.
Like, I hope my hands need to breathe better. But then he hit, like, a halfway point. And it looks like the two, like it was two cables and they were crimped together in the middle. And there was just like a hunk of shit hanging off of the, zipline.
Like one of them was like, it like it was frayed at the end.
It looked like a frayed rope.
And then they like crimped them together with like a, I don't know, it was not.
Like one of those like clamshell things. Yeah. They bolted down on either side. Yeah, but then he said that he's sitting on just like it's literally a plank of wood with like with like some twine holding it together. And then he gets off of the plank. This whole time he's 2,000 feet in the air. No. This whole time. And he like throws his legs up over the cable. So now he's hanging upside down like a trapeze.
Yeah.
And he just like one for the money and two for the show, and he's just like leaps off the thing and pulls his parachute. And I'm just like, you know, if your parachute were to fail, you'd have a lot of time to think.
Yeah.
Right? As you're plummeting towards the earth. Like, this could have been avoided. Like the only person responsible for this is me.
Yeah, you brought up a good point. I wonder how they got that cable from, like, one mountain to the other.
It had to have been a helicopter.
I mean, that's really the only reasonable explanation as to how you could even do that.
Yeah, because if it was, like, two dudes, like, just two Russian dudes, first of all, that cable, that length of cables is...
It would take you a week to do
several
it.
Several hundred pounds.
Because you would have to go up the side of one mountain.
Yeah.
Where you're going to take and, like, throw the rest of it down.
Yeah.
Like, you're talking about like, tons of cable.
Yeah. You'd have to, like, nail it down in the first place and then, like, walk all the way back down the mountain across the valley to the next one. And they were probably, I don't know, it was a long way.
No.
5,000 feet?
No. Across. Somewhere in the Ural Mountains somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah, no thank you.
No, I'm good.
It reminds me of earlier today. Not that I was just, well, actually I was. Mary and I went to the county fair, the county that she works at, had an employee appreciation thing.
No,
and so we went over there. It was nice. We usually go. I think we go every year. We just kind of walk around and we don't really ride a whole lot of rides or anything.
Food.
I did.
Oh, I love fair
food. Italian sausage with like peppers and onions on it. But they also fed us for free. Like we got free food because she was with the county.
Yeah,
but we saw a pig race. That was fun.
Oh yeah.
We had walked all the way from one end to the other. They have like a little like building down there where they will show off. Like, I guess every year they do like a vegetable growing contest and then like an art contest and a photography contest. Yeah. And they have all these tables laid out with like all the participants and the winners and everything. Yeah. And the winner of the vegetable contest this year was this fucking watermelon that was no shit as big as this table.
Really?
Yeah. Like from end to end, it was probably about 3.5 feet long.
Yeah.
And then in circumference, like, I don't know, about as big around as two basketballs. Yeah. But we walked all the way to one end of the fair and walked all the way back. And we're almost at the gate. And Mary says, "Do you want to ride the chairs?" And I was like, "Fuck." I was like, "Whatever you want to do, baby." So, I really didn't want to ride the chairs. But I was like, "I'll hold it together for Mary. Mary wants to do it." I hate the fucking chairs, like the suspended things.
Oh, yeah.
Because, like, it's one thing if it's at, like, an amusement park that's, like, you know,
got insurance.
That and then, like, you know, is kind of like an institution, you know, it's been
there. They actually
have,
like, maintenance men.
Yeah.
Not like just, this. Not just some fucking carny.
Yeah, this is fucking put together by some fucking dope fiend. The only sleep he's had is a heroin nap. But we got on the thing, and it's like, you know, like the seat that we're sitting on doesn't really come all the way past the middle of my thigh, so right. I kind of feel like I'm leaned forward a little right. bit the whole time. And there's just this little bar in front of us, and we're so high. It's not that high, but it feels
high.
Like it's really high. Like, I'm not supposed to be up this high.
Right.
And the fucking thing, they quits moving several times, because I guess somebody was taking too long to get off. Because it's supposed to just keep moving. You're supposed to, like, you know, when you go to sit on it, it's supposed to kind of hit you in the back of the legs, and you just kind of sit into it, and it never stops. But it stopped like three times, and we're just like suspended in the air, and it's like kind of bouncing a little bit, you know, and the wind was blowing. And then I made the mistake of like looking at like the one that was coming this way at the top of it.
No, don't do that.
Like, how is this thing attached to this cable? Right. And it literally, there's this like, you had the little thing you're sitting in, and off the top of it is this long pole with like a little, it's not even hooked.
Yeah.
Like this, it's like an L shape, and the cable is going through like one of those little clamshell like deals. I was like, that's all that's holding us up here.
Right.
I weigh almost 300 pounds. I'm 265, and that thing is plus the weight of this and my wife, and it's just like,
it's like by the time that my chair has reached like inertia at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't weigh 300 pounds anymore. It's like, I weigh more like 2,000 pounds. And that thing's screaming up there.
I was like, but that's all that's holding me on up there.
No.
It's like just fucking, just walking the razor's edge here. But we got down on the other side, and I almost fell to my knees and kissed the ground. I told Mary, I was like, please don't ever make me do that again. They had the swings, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And not the ones that, like, just kind of, it sits on the ground, the one that goes way up in the air.
Right.
And I think Six Flags has got one like that now that's, like,
oh, do they?
Several hundred feet.
Mm-mm, I don't like that.
Yeah. And it's just you on a swing.
I don't like that at all. You remember the Six Flags, they used to have, It wasn't like a thrill ride, but it was real, real tall. And like, it was just like a bucket that you set in, and it would take you all the way to the top.
Yeah, the parachutes, I think, is what it was called.
Yeah,
right?
Something like that.
Yeah, it would take you all the way up, and then it would drop you down real slow.
Yeah.
And it was a long fucking way up.
Right.
Like
uncomfortably, like
20 stories.
Right.
Right. I'm pretty sure it
was. You'd get up there and you heard like the gears creaking.
Yeah,
and
you're like, I don't mind to get off now.
So, and there would always be like a pause because they're actively loading people at the bottom.
Yeah.
And essentially, like, it acts as like a counterweight.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't like this.
Don't like it. It's like, hit me down.
No. Well, what was the other one? I don't know if they have it over there anymore. Was it Acrophobia?
Acrophobia's still there. You can see it from the interstate.
I remember the first time I ever rode that stupid ride, and the last time I ever rode that stupid ride.
That was the same
ride.
For me, yeah. Once was enough.
I got on it, and it's just like this shitty, like, plastic, like, girder that, like, goes over the top of you. It doesn't close all the way, and the seat's not big enough, and it's just like this shitty, like, plastic hook. Like, goes in
whatever
front of
that,
your,
like, nub thing is that sticks between your legs.
Yeah.
It, like, separated my nuts, like, when I went on it. And then, like, when they hit the brakes on the way down, it, like forced it between my legs. Like the Spanish donkey. I was, like, getting split in half.
But I just remember getting up there, and I was like, wow, this is really high up. And I was like, oh, they'll just do like the on my count three and then drop you on two.
Yeah.
And I didn't realize that the seats also tilt forward. And immediately I was like trying to suck in back into the seat and like close it and get it to click an extra click.
Like, what if it was like one of those things where like that extra click was the release?
It's like,
you're like, dang. Like, it only comes down fast. We can't make it come down slow.
They're like, get back in your seat, sir.
Yes, sir. Give me. Like, it's your fault. It's like the SWAT standoff. They're like, just get back in your seat, sir. We can avoid all this. As a matter of fact, I think where the parachutes were, that is where the swings are now, the ones that go way up high.
Because I remember that one used to be like towards like the back of the park back there.
It was
there.
Over near where Goliath is, in that kind of same area.
Yeah, that was such a very long time ago. I thought that was like more towards the back, towards like a Scream Machine, like back near that little retention pond that they had back there.
Oh, yeah. Scream Machine over there, you had the wheelie, you had... Ninja was the one that would beat you to death.
Scream Machine. Last time I went there was many years ago, but
yeah,
the Scream Machine was really bad too. Yeah.
I was talking to Mary about it today. I had heard that Six Flags is like a no-go zone.
Really?
Just with like how dangerous it is.
Yeah.
Which sucks because like we went there all the time when we were kids.
Yeah.
But now it's like you don't want to go there.
Was it like a lot of crime or
just like a lot of youths? I don't know how else to put it. They implemented some kind of law, or not law.
Six Flags law around here. Yeah. They implemented it's like some, Boss Hog.
Boss Hog. they implemented some kind of rule that was like people 16 and under couldn't be there like without a chaperone.
Dumb.
But is that even enforced? And if it is enforced, is a 17-year-old that much better than a 16-year-old?
No, right.
So.
Yeah, I mean, anytime you get a bunch of, like, shithead, like, teenage boys somewhere, they're going to cause fucking problems.
Oh, yeah. No matter where it is.
No matter where it is. It doesn't matter.
Because I used to be a teenage boy. Yeah. And that's what I did.
Yeah, I caused fucking problems and was a shithead.
I mean, it's one thing if you're just kind of being a nuisance, but it's another thing entirely if you're, like, being violent.
Yeah, violent, yeah.
Yeah.
Right. That's disappointing because I had considered taking autumn, but I was just like, it's such a hassle fucking going up there.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so many people in the lines and expensive and shit.
And it's hot.
Yeah.
And the food's so expensive. Yeah. Well, they, you know, I'm sure that they've added a ton of shit. So, I mean, the last time I've been there, I think the last time I went was 10th grade. It's been a long time since I've been there. I'm sure that they've added a lot of stuff since then. I know that they added like a whole water park.
Yeah, that was a very long time ago, though, I think. Yeah.
I've always been a big fan of amusement parks. At least I was when I was a little kid. Like, now I get motion sickness, which I didn't used to, because fucking why not? And I got to thinking about, like, Universal Studios. I think I've gone, like, a total of 2 or 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
Not including the time we went for, like, the Halloween thing.
Right.
But I remembered, did they have a portion of the park where it was like you were shrunk down and you were in, like,
yeah, I think that was Disney, though.
That was it Disney?
Yeah, it was Disney because it was based on Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. Because me and Allison were having this conversation. How long has it been since you've seen Honey, I Shrunk the Kids?
Oh, God, it's been
ages. So like, there's a big portion of that movie where, like, they're in the yard.
Yeah.
And, like, if you remember, there was a portion of, like, that little area where it was, like, it was like a slide, and you would slide down, like, a blade of grass.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and there was, like, a big Lego.
Yeah.
Remember? Yeah,
I do
it was based
that.
Off that movie.
Okay, yeah. I just had, like, that thought one day. I was just, it just kind of popped into my head. I was like, is that a real thing? Like, did I actually experience that?
Yeah, I'm pretty certain that that was Disney.
I know Disney's the one that was it Galaxy's Edge? The Star Wars one, where you can go inside, like, the Millennium Falcon.
Is that recent?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't.
I mean, obviously it's Disney because they own Star Wars.
I have not been to Disney since last time our parents took us to Disney.
It's been a while.
And I'm actively trying to avoid it with my daughter.
Like, that just seems like such a fucking miserable, awful experience.
For everyone.
For everyone involved.
Right.
Like, first of all, it's in Florida or California. So no, like, temperate states. Very warm areas. And there's just so many people.
Yeah.
Like, I had heard before that they were planning on, or they were thinking about having, like, a soft cap of, like, how many people could be in the park at one time. Because they would have so many people in that you couldn't have a good time.
Right.
Because it was just...
It's impossible.
People on top of people. Yeah.
Right.
Like, from one end of the park, like, you couldn't, like, there was no... You couldn't, like, reach out like this and not touch a person.
Right.
And that just doesn't sound fun.
No, and... The person that we know that went was the last person that I know that went down there was saying how like outrageously expensive it is.
Mm-hmm.
Like if I'm not mistaken, I think that this person stated they spent over like $10,000 just on the trip. Yeah,
$10,000.
Yeah,
I didn't spend.
I mean, you think about like because I looked at the prices and everything for like if you're staying like at a resort there.
Yeah.
It's like $800 a night just for the room.
That is way too much money to spend to be so angry.
And then you're also, I mean, that's just the room. That's not, you know,
you're not in the park
food
yet.
Or passes to get into the park or parking for everywhere that you go.
Good God.
Every day.
Good God. There's no reason. I can't think of any reason for it to be that much.
No.
There's no reason it should be that much.
I can think... of many different things, I would rather spend $10,000 on. If somebody gave me $10,000, my first thought would never be, "Oh boy, I can go to Disney World now."
I know.
I'd be like, "Fuck that mouse! He's not getting this money."
If somebody handed me $10,000, I would just put it in the bank and pretend like I didn't have it.
Right.
Because you never know. I never. A fucking tree might fall on my house.
Right.
You know, and then I'm at fucking Disney.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get like a ring alarm.
Yeah. Oh, I hope that was fun. You're totally fucked when you got this.
Oh, gosh. Looks like a tree fell on your house. Yeah, that sounds so fucking bad. And I know that like Dad took us to, or they took us to, was that Animal Kingdom? Or yeah, they had like a safari version.
Yeah, it was Animal Kingdom, and then I think we went to like one of the water parks.
Yeah.
And maybe Epcot, I think we went to.
I just remember Dad talking about how fucking hot it was. He said it was like 115 degrees in Florida.
Yeah, I remember it was fucking hot that day.
And he's, and like I was too, me and Aaron both were kind of too young to really remember a whole lot of it, but he's like, Aaron was like just sitting on his shoulders and he was having to like drag me along
because
I'm tired. And he's just, yeah, woohoo, what a great family fun trip.
Yeah. Family fun day.
Yeah. $10,000. That's insane. You could go, if you spent what we spent to go to Italy, you could do it 3 times in a row with $10,000.
Well, you know, not only that, but it's like, there's like a very certain type of person that is constantly going to Disney.
Yes.
And they're a bunch of fucking weirdos.
Yeah, Disney adults.
Yeah, Disney adults. Yeah.
Like, I mean, there are people who go frequently, but there are people who go like any chance that they get.
Like, they're going like 5 to 6 times a year.
Yeah.
And it's I just don't fucking get it. Yeah. I don't understand it. It's like, because I've seen them like in commercials.
Especially if you don't have kids.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. There was a commercial with this lady. And she's like, I just have such a good time when I'm here. And she's like crying and like wearing the fucking Mickey Mouse ears. I'm just like, what type of like Orwellian dystopia am I fucking living in where there's some adult, some 28-year-old.
Yeah, wearing plastic ears.
You're wearing plastic ears.
Sobbing about how fun Disneyland is.
Like, are they holding your family hostage? Does somebody have your child behind, like, held at gunpoint behind the camera?
Mm. It's just like, what level of escapism do you need?
Yeah, but what the fuck is going on in your life?
In your personal life, yeah. You have to go to such a degree to feel happiness.
It's like, have you ever maybe considered, like, taking care of the things that you need to take care of at home before you try to like escape to the House of Mouse.
The House of Mouse. That's just so much money to spend, though. Like, that many times a year?
And for what?
Like, yeah, what, and for what? Yeah, so, what, like, what are you take
really
home?
Getting out of this? Not only that, but, like, you also have to take into consideration, like, we live, like, markedly closer to Orlando than, like, somebody maybe from, like, Nebraska.
Yeah, like, right in the middle of the state. Yeah.
Like, somebody that's, like, lives in, like, Branson, Missouri, would or like Minneapolis, Minnesota, would have to like fly down.
Yeah, there's
to
another. There's another cost. Yeah, there's a fucking airplane ticket.
Yeah, there's for a family of five. There goes another $5,000.
Oh my god!
On top of your rental that you don't have to get,
and then you get down there and it's fucking hot, and the kids don't want to fucking walk, and we're hungry, but you can't eat any of that fucking park food because it costs $45 to feed one person.
And then that's how you end up on Snapped.
Yeah, for real, yeah. That's how people go fucking crazy, is going to Disney once with your family.
Well, not only that, but like I feel like Universal is like much more affordable. I don't know what the prices are now, but I know that back when we lived in Jacksonville, like just looking at the prices just to get into the park, Universal was much more affordable just to get into.
And every bit as fun as Disney World.
Oh, yeah. I mean, not only that, but you also had like...
They had more rides.
Yeah, SeaWorld was like right down the road from there, and that one was super affordable to get into, and they have rides and everything there that you can go do. Yeah. I mean, I know that's not like... People don't like... They're not saving up for 5 years to go to SeaWorld. Yeah. You know?
Like, if you are, like, do something different. Yeah.
You need to maybe make a career change.
Make a little bit better choice there.
But, you know... I don't understand like the fervor of which people sort of like defend Disney.
Yeah, I don't get it. Especially considering how just evil that corporation is. Just blatantly evil. They hate everything you love.
Right.
Come spend $10,000 here. I remember just thinking about Disney, that so they had Pandora World, right? Where it was supposed to be like Avatar, like with like the floating rocks or whatever. And I remember hearing like when Avatar first released, there were people who were depressed after watching the movie because the world could never be as beautiful as Pandora was.
Ugh. Ugh.
It's like, what are you talking about?
What is that guy? He's like, beta.
Oh, man. I just don't understand like how people can get so engrossed in entertainment media.
Yeah.
People will base their whole lives around it.
It'd be like me getting upset that I don't live in Middle Earth.
Yeah.
And I'm not 3 foot tall and have hairy feet.
I mean, really, like, just go to New Zealand if that's what you want. Yeah. They filmed the whole thing there with minimal changes.
Like, yeah, unfortunately, I don't meet two of the three requirements. Because I'm 6 foot tall and I don't live in Middle Earth, but I still have the hairy feet. I have the one shitty part that I didn't want.
You'd just be like, like a free hobbit. Yeah.
They're like, he's the one that lives in the tree. What a fucking freak.
And another thing with Disney too is like, Disney has like a lot of stigma around it. You know, depending on, and it's weird to say, but depending on what side of the political aisle you're on.
Yeah.
Like, people on the right typically do not like Disney because of a lot of what they feel are transgressions against them.
Yeah.
Like, with all the diversity and the inclusivity.
Yeah.
And granted, it is kind of a lot.
Yeah.
Like, Disney, maybe we can pull back on a little bit of that.
Right.
Like, not everybody that was white needs to now be black.
Right.
Like, we can let some of this just remain.
It's okay to have some white people in there.
It's just a couple. Like, Snow White, but you know, we changed that one, too.
White is, like, in the name. Did you see the trailer for that where somebody was like Snow White and the seven diverse people?
Really?
Well, like, none of them are dwarves.
They're not?
No. And apparently, I guess, like, they had initially were going to cast, like, people that are that have, I guess, dwarfism.
Yeah.
And then Peter Dinklage made a big fucking stink about it. And it's like, and you know, to me,
well, he is.
Yeah, exactly. So the way that I see that is that I've made my money.
Yeah.
And now I'm pulling up the ladder behind me. Fuck you.
That's exactly what that looks like.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you weren't hired for like so people could make fun of you.
Right.
You were hired because you fit a role.
Right.
And there's seven roles
exactly
that would be perfect for people exactly. like you. And yeah, that seems
they
like a
break
huge
break into the industry and make a good amount of money. You know, you could, you know, you're talking about, you know, they wouldn't be main characters. They would be supporting cast, but
tens of thousands of dollars, maybe
hundreds of thousands of dollars. You're talking about somebody that would be on set for a while, and I'm sure that while they're on set, they're taken care of.
Yeah.
But as far as like their salary for while they're on set, they'd probably get paid $600,000.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's gone to just some fucking person over here.
Yeah.
That doesn't even meet the requirements to what a dwarf would even be.
Yeah. That seems really shitty.
It's like, so you've just snatched away seven possibilities for people.
Seven opportunities for people who had the same struggle as you.
Exactly.
Wow.
Yeah, you just seem like a real cunt.
Yeah.
And not only that, but it's like if you are Disney and you are looking to, oh, I don't know, have diversity and inclusion.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you want to include a diverse group of people who are not represented very often?
Yeah.
In media. AKA or people with dwarfism.
Thing? Yeah.
Wouldn't you kind of want to hire these people?
There were seven opportunities roles to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're like stepping on your own toes.
Yeah. It does seem, what's the word? Not counterintuitive. What's the word where it goes back on itself? Hypocritical?
Yeah.
I don't even know if hypocritical is the right word, but what I'm trying to say is like, you know, when they strive so hard for the whole diversity and inclusion and everything like that, like it's like a snake eating its own tail.
Right.
Like it eventually comes back around to only having one type of person.
Yeah, exactly.
Like filling all the roles. And then you're going to be like, okay, well, we got to add white people back into this, and like we need more white people shown, and then like all of a sudden it's nothing but white people again.
Yeah, now it's all white people. Congratulations, you played yourself.
It's like, you know, I don't understand. Okay, here's a good point. It's all about like the way people think about this stuff nowadays too. I've been replaying. I replayed all of the Gears of War games because they were all on Game Pass.
Yeah.
Like all of them. I was like, oh, shit. I'll just run through these. And the first three are just so completely different than like the last two.
Yeah.
Like the last two came about in this kind of like modern era.
Yeah.
And then the first three were like the Xbox 360, like, suck my fucking cock. Yeah. Yeah, fucking everything's brown and gray. Yeah. And, yeah. It just had a whole different feel to it.
Yeah.
And the first two games, there's a character called Anya. I don't know if you remember. It's been a while since you've played her, but she was like a blonde woman.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
They never presented her as like somebody who was incapable because she was a woman. Like they never presented her as like a damsel in distress or anything like that. Like in the first two games, she was like, you know, like a high ranking official, like in the army.
Right.
And you're just like, okay, that's her job. That's who she is. Well, then in the third game, all of a sudden she's like, you know, boots on the ground, like in the squad, she's fighting all the guys too.
Yeah.
And I remember, like at the time when Gears 3 came out, no one ever said fucking anything about that.
No.
No one cared that all of a sudden there was a woman in the group. It was just like, hey, I know that character, and now she's fighting with us. Okay, this is cool. Let's go have some fun.
Yeah.
But then, like, I was like, well, why am I noticing it now?
Right. Like, what has changed? What is different?
Yeah. Why, like, I was like, I remember because I saw her, and she was wearing, like, the get-up, like, the armor, and she had the gun. And I was just, I kind of had this, like, very faint, like, ugh, like, moment. But I was like, wait, I didn't feel that way before.
Right.
I was like, I don't feel that way now, but I just had this, like, knee-jerk reaction to seeing that. It was like, because I've been conditioned to see that any time that there's a woman being portrayed as, like, a hero, I see it
as at the expense of the males that are also right.
Yeah.
Well, that's why it's not hard to write a strong female character.
No, it's been done a thousand times.
That plays the hero. It's like, look at Alien.
Alien is the prime example.
Yeah, that's a prime example of having a strong female hero character. But that character is not written at the expense of other characters.
Yeah, she didn't have to put anybody else down in order to lift herself up. She was just capable of her own merit.
Yeah, it's sort of also like Terminator.
Yeah.
Like the mother in the first Terminator movie, she is for the most part, she is the hero of the movie.
Yeah.
It's like, but also it's not at the expense of the other characters in the movie.
See, it was just I just thought it was interesting because like there was a time where they could introduce a female protagonist and everybody just kind of accepted it.
Right. Well, look at Samus with Metroid.
Yeah, exactly. But now, every time a female protagonist is introduced, everybody has a reaction to it. And I think the reason why is because people started introducing female protagonists as a way to get at someone.
Right.
As a way to,
bring down the patriarchy.
Bring down the patriarchy.
Right.
And now it's like, okay, well, all you did was push everybody further back into this hole that, first of all, didn't exist to begin with.
Right.
And now you've pushed them all in there, and now every time they see a woman, they're just like... Yeah. So you created the problem. Right. It's the most amazing thing.
Yeah.
One day you said that there was a problem, and then you set out to fight it, and in fighting it, you created it.
Right. You're out there yelling into the void.
Yeah, and you manifested this thing. Yeah,
it's like, how did you manage to do that?
Yeah, created your own enemy. But yeah, like, you know, Samus is a perfect example. Like, the first time I ever even saw Samus in anything was in fucking Smash Bros.
Yeah.
I didn't know who she was prior to that.
Right.
And in Smash Bros., as far as I knew, it was a fucking robot.
Right.
I was like, oh, cool, it's a robot. He's got a gun for an arm.
Yeah.
And then Metroid Prime came out, and in the opening cutscene, or I think it's in the opening cutscene, they make mention that she's a woman, or that you see her with her helmet off, and she's just a blonde white woman.
Yeah.
And I was never like, oh, it's a girl. I was never like, oh, it's, you know, they just put her in here to get at the men, to bring down the patriarchy. Yeah. I literally was like, oh, cool, it's a girl.
Right.
I didn't expect that. And then I played the game.
Right.
And never thought anything about it.
Right.
And I don't know if that was innocence that is now lost or what, but I think that the whole diversity and inclusion thing is creating the problem it's trying to fix.
I think it's just one of those things where it just kind of compounds on itself, where it's like the diversity and inclusion people, like, they do it, but they do it in a way in which they're like...
For the wrong reason.
They're doing it for the wrong, almost for the wrong reason. So it's not that they're really concerned with, like... helping people that, you know, would need additional help to get the attention that they need to break into, like, roles or anything.
Like, so, underrepresented groups.
It's not that they actually fucking care about them.
Yeah.
It's that they really hate, like, what they call the patriarchy. That's what they really want to do. So it's like, if it wasn't for diversity and inclusion, they would just use something else to get at the thing that they hate. So I think that if it was approached differently, so if it was approached as like, if the original intent and approach, I think, maybe had been a little less combative.
Yeah.
Like, I think that...
If you just naturally introduced more female characters.
Right.
Instead of saying, here's female characters and here's why.
Yeah. And so that created an issue with... like the men's rights groups and all that stuff. Give us back our foreskins. So,
oh god,
it's like you had, and then like that creates a problem, and then now they're yelling at one another, and it just becomes like more and more polarized.
Yeah,
and it's like, and it's also, it doesn't help because now you have like young men that are taking themselves like out of the dating pool, and they don't trust women.
I was just about to ask if you heard about that. Was it Men Go Their Own Way?
Yeah.
Thing,
and like, that's not healthy for society.
No, that's really concerning. It's for anybody who doesn't know, Men Go Their Own Way. Is this like, would you call it a movement?
Yeah, I mean, I guess you could call it a movement. I think it's more of a reaction to...
Yeah, it's very like reactionary.
Into like fourth wave feminism.
Yeah, it's very reactionary. It's a movement for basically what it stands for. It's, you know, men completely taking, like you said, taking themselves out of the dating pool and just disregarding women entirely.
Right.
And just focusing on things like material gain and like
right.
their professional status and so on and so forth. And, you know, that is the same thing that women started doing in the 80s.
Right.
Was disregarding men, focusing on material possession and all this stuff, this, that, and the other. So you have, like, these career women.
Right.
Who very late in life realized, like, oh, this didn't get me anything.
Right.
I don't have a family. I don't have anything.
I have nobody to share this with.
I have nobody to share this with. And not to say that there weren't men who experienced that same thing. There obviously were.
No.
But now there is a force driving them into that direction.
Right. Well, it's not good for anybody. It's not good for men. It's not good for women.
No.
It's not good for society as a whole. Like, because you're also, that's going to decrease the birth rate, which is not good for,
yeah.
It's just not good. It's not good. And the more, like, people push the whole, like, differentiation between the two groups.
Yeah.
Like, it's just going to make it worse.
It's really crazy that there's such a focus and a fervor for inclusion and diversity and equity and all these other things. But every action that is taken draws a distinction between every single group.
No.
Nothing is diverse. There's just several segments.
Right.
And there's no equity. It's everybody's suffering alone.
Right.
So it's just interesting that it really seems like it's working against itself.
Right. Yeah, I'm just not sure exactly like what the end goal was for, like, when you talk about, because from my understanding, the whole like diversity, equity, and inclusion thing has been brought about by like the trained Marxists. So like the people that, I guess you could say they're like Bolsheviks, almost like from like the Russian Revolution, when the Red Army took over and everything, where it's like, in order for people to sort of give over like their own independence and liberty, like you kind of have to separate the individual from the family unit. So you have to sort of, you almost have to discourage the two genders from like seeing each other, not as like equals, but as people that would benefit from having a relationship with the other one, because it's almost like a yin and yang type deal.
Yeah.
Like for the most part, men are one way and women are the other way.
Yeah.
It's like, so the two sort of have to come together in order to form a more perfect union.
Yeah.
You know,
like we both need each other.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. So with the attack, I would consider attack on like the nuclear family structure. Like that's not helping anyone.
No.
And it's not helping the children at all.
No. If anybody's suffering, it's the kids.
Right.
There has been you're right to call it an attack. There has been several institutions and groups and everything that have risen and come to power like in the past decade and a half that all want to see the dissolution of the nuclear family. Probably the biggest perpetrator of that is Black Lives Matter. Like if you go on their website or whatever, that's like one of their tenets. Yeah, is the dissolution of the nuclear family. And the crazy thing is, and the reason that it's listed is because they define that as part of white supremacy.
Yeah, but under what pretext or circumstance?
I have no idea.
See, that's the thing. Like when people do that kind of stuff, it's like they just kind of throw that out there.
Yeah.
It's like, well, under what circumstance are you saying that that is the case?
Yeah.
And it's like, well, just it is.
Yeah, it's very hand wavy.
Yeah, it's very hand wavy.
Oh,
it's like,
just
well,
white
do you
supremacy,
have any like peer-reviewed articles or anything that I can read that might
facts.
Yeah, but it's like it's always just very like it's very like, oh, just trust me, bro.
Yeah, you know? My source is that I made it the fuck up.
Yeah,
yeah.
Well, it's like now, and it's so crazy to me that with the internet, like, we just have access to all this information, and all the information is just shit
wrong.
Information.
It's all wrong information.
It's just all shit wrong information. It's like, it's all bad. Like, none of it's any good.
Doesn't help anyone.
Because, I mean, you would think that with just this access to, all, like, this unlimited information, because, I mean, I will give the internet its due. It's like, you can learn a lot. I learn shit all the time from just watching YouTube videos.
Constantly, yeah.
It's like, if you don't know how, like, a two-cycle engine works, you can go on YouTube and somebody has, like, broken it down fucking Sesame Street style.
Yeah, here's exactly how this fucking thing works.
Yeah, they'll have, like, a graphic and they'll show you this is what happens. Mm-hmm. Like, the fuel comes in, there's the spark plug lights the ignition, and then it presses it down, and then it brings it back up, and it pushes it back out the exhaust.
Yeah.
It's like it will show you and break everything down for you. And there's a lot of YouTube videos online that are very educational.
Yeah.
It's like, but
and not a guy rubbing air on his asshole.
Yeah, exactly.
Kind of educational. It's like legitimate education.
Yeah, legitimate education. But I just think that, like, for all of our faults, like, we just tend to, like, move towards, like, the shitty information.
Yeah. Yeah. We definitely have a tendency to go in the wrong direction. Yeah. I'm pretty sure there's a dude on YouTube whose entire channel is like a 30 video playlist teaching calculus.
Really?
Yeah, and there's like I've heard several people say like they followed along the videos from like start to end and learned calculus.
Really?
Yeah. I of course haven't done it because fuck math.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean there's all kinds of like crazy videos on YouTube where you can learn all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
Like there's
you just give the time to it.
Yeah. Like there's another guy that I watch sometimes, the lock picking lawyer.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, like where he'll like teach you how to pick a lock. Yeah. And I think that's fucking fascinating.
Yeah, it is. Well, he's also one of those instances of it's really fun to watch people who are extremely good at what they do.
Well, not only good, but they're also very like passionate about like what it is that they do. You know?
That's a big thing too, is people that are passionate about something.
Right.
It's like it's you know, that's why it's always kind of nice to hear people talk about things that they're passionate about, because you can just kind of see that spark in them.
Yeah.
Even if you don't really understand what it is they're talking about, you know.
Well, it just kind of makes you think, especially too, like with the way that like the whole education system is kind of set up. It's like, I think a lot of people get into like education for like the right reasons. They're like, they want to make an impact on kids and like see them like spark an interest in learning something.
Yeah.
But it's like, but at the same time, there's like all this bureaucracy and like bullshit that they have to go through.
I think people are blindsided
and
by it.
It just kind of like grinds them into dust.
Yeah. You just become a goon. Yeah. You're just a fucking educational goon.
So, but like you said, like there's all this stuff on YouTube that you can go and learn.
Yeah.
It's like, if you are actually interested in learning calculus, like you could go to this guy's YouTube channel and he's passionate about
it. He'll teach you how to do it. Yeah. And there's other resources too, like Wikipedia. I think one of the worst things that ever happened was schools and teachers telling everybody that Wikipedia is an unreliable source.
Yeah.
Because yes, it is possible for anybody to go and edit. But usually if it's something erroneous, it gets caught really quickly.
Right.
And usually it's never anything that's, like, subtle.
Right.
Usually it's on, like, Marilyn Manson's page. And it's like, oh, he's actually a lizard with a 40-foot-long tongue, and that's how he sucks his own dick. Yeah. And if you read that, nobody's going to read that and be like, oh, my God, I got to let the world know. Yeah. It says it right here on Wikipedia.
Well, the nice thing about Wikipedia too is like even if you don't, if you're not able to use Wikipedia as a resource, Wikipedia also has its reference page, and you can go to those references.
Yeah, it's just a good resource in itself.
Right.
I mean, you know, there's I can't tell you how many times like I've gone like down like Wikipedia rabbit holes.
No.
Like I just wanted to know about something, and it's insane that we take it for granted that it's free.
Yeah.
Like, that's why I don't mind if Wikipedia asks me for a couple of dollars.
Right.
Like, I give $2 every time it asks me. I literally do. Because it's just it's such an incredible resource. And it's saved my ass several times.
Dumb.
Like, in school, in my in a professional setting.
Right. Well, I mean, it's also, too, it's, you know, Reddit for all of its fucking faults.
And there are plenty.
And there are plenty. I mean, but there's been plenty of times where I've been stumped about something to do with school or with my job or anything. And most of the time, if I just type in my question and then put Reddit behind it, somebody has asked that question.
Has already had that problem.
And most of the time, if I go to that thread, there's a pretty good chance that somebody has answered that question.
There's nothing worse, though, than like finding a forum on like some fucking website that existed 40 years ago. And it's like some guy's like, hey, is anybody else having this problem? And then like there's one comment and he's like, yeah, let me know. And then like nothing ever comes of it. It's just now we're just three confused people.
Or there's like somebody that's like 3 years later, it's like, do you ever figure that out?
Yeah. Anybody here? It's like stumbling upon a cavern. That happens all the time if I'm looking at like automotive issues.
Dumb.
Yeah. And the thing about automotive issues is, like, they're always so specific.
Yeah.
They're specific to the make and model and year of your car. And trim package also has a lot to do with it. And then, like, you might find a fix that's, like, the exact same car as you, but it's, like, a year before, so they don't use that particular, like, wiring schematic anymore or anything. And it's just, it's, like, good fucking luck trying to even troubleshoot.
Right.
You know, it's not, you haven't even gotten to the point yet where do I have the tools or the capability to fix the problem.
Right.
Like, I need to figure out what the problem actually is.
Well, that's what one of the reasons why I liked my truck when we bought it was that it has an analog dash.
Oh, nice.
So that way
there's less shit that can go wrong.
There's less shit that can go wrong. And I can actually see the fucking gauges for all my shit.
Yeah.
It's like I can tell, like when I turn the truck on, I can see what the voltage is on the battery.
Mm-hmm.
I can see how much oil I have in the fucking like in the fucking thing.
You don't have to like go through menus.
Yeah, I don't have to go through menus or any of that shit.
Yeah.
Well, it's like with Allison's car, it's like there's no, I can't tell like what the voltage is on the battery. It won't fucking tell you.
Yeah.
It's like go get a fucking multimeter because I'm not gonna fucking tell you.
Yeah. Good luck.
Yeah. Or it doesn't tell you like, oh, like this is what your oil reading is, or this is what your engine temp is.
Like you'll know there's a problem.
Yeah.
when the problem gets here, you'll know.
It's like, but like I remember working on the truck when we had the truck. It was easy.
You talking about the Sierra?
Yeah, the Sierra.
Oh,
like
yeah.
You'd pop it open in the engine compartment, like you could see all the shit.
Everything
was
so accessible.
You could see right down to the fucking
down
you could
to the
see,
ground.
You could see down to the ground.
Yeah.
It's like there's no fucking way.
Yeah, no.
You could do that with a modern vehicle because they pack so much shit in there.
That's the thing is, like, they overcomplicate, like, these very simple systems that don't need to be overcomplicated.
Right.
Because when you create, especially if you take, like, an analog gauge cluster, like, for instance, your fucking fuel tank gauge or whatever, the moment that you take that away from, like, a physical system and turn it into, like, an electric thing, that's just another thing to go wrong.
Right.
And who knows if there's, like, some kind of redundancy in the car's onboard computer where you have the fuel gauge light turns off, the whole car doesn't fucking work.
Right.
And then you'll never know that that was the problem.
Or that your fucking motherboard shorts out.
Yeah.
And then you can't start the car at all.
When I was, after the Impala had shit the bed, I was looking for a new car.
Once it arrived at the gates of hell.
We went and looked at a Jaguar XF.
Yeah.
Just to see it. And the gear shift is flush with the center console until you crank the car up. And then it rises up out of the center console.
That.
So there's like a little motor whose sole fucking purpose is to push the gear shift up out of it.
Nope.
And I'm like, if something ever went wrong with that.
That's my thought with everything now. It's like, that'll break. I'll have to fix that.
Yeah.
It's like, just because I know it's built for shit. It's like it's built by a bunch of people that don't give a fuck.
That don't give a fuck.
Yeah, that don't fucking care.
I just did this job and then went home.
Yeah. It's like the same people that want to make three times what they're making already so they can make the same shit fucking product that I'm going to have to take to the fucking shop.
I have to go back, spend three times as much on it.
Yeah. Well, it's like I was telling you the other night at dinner where, was it the United Auto Workers? They're like requesting like triple their fucking pay. Mm-hmm. It's like, and they're just like nobody's gonna fucking agree to that.
Triple your pay for what?
Yeah, for fucking what?
For what?
Yeah, what? So I can buy this $90,000 truck and it break 2 fucking weeks later, and have me take it into the fucking shop so that they can fucking fix it?
Yeah.
No, thank you.
And then all the mechanics are getting paid triple?
Yeah.
Like, how much is it going to fucking cost me now?
Right.
Like, I'm so glad that you're now earning $200 an hour to turn a spanner wrench.
Yeah. That way your union bosses can get 150 of it.
Yeah.
That way they can sit there and with their thumb up their ass, jerking their cocks. That way they can make all this money.
And now I'm fucked.
Yeah.
And all I wanted to do was buy a Honda Civic. Now it costs $180,000.
Well, I mean, that was the big three.
Yeah.
Like the big three, like American automotives or whatever, which is Ford, GMC, and then Ford, Chevy, GMC, and Dodge.
Yeah.
So
Chrysler.
Yeah. So, I mean, and make no mistake about it, these are not American-made vehicles anymore. These cars are being made in Mexico because of NAFTA, because it's easier for them to send that down there because there's no tariffs that they have to pay because it's just a free trade agreement between Canada, U.S., and Mexico.
Yeah.
So, like, you don't have to pay any taxes as they're going back and forth across the border.
Yeah,
and then you can pay Manuel down there. Fucking, you know, below fucking minimum wage because he's willing to fucking accept it. It's
and
like
then,
that. And then,
Manuel crosses the border and they still pay his ass $2
exactly.
an hour.
Exactly. So it's in.
But now he's voting in our elections.
But, I mean, that just goes to show you how fucked up it is.
Yeah.
It's like because not only have you taken a job away from somebody, but that person is now going to have to go find employment somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, but you've also taken that job away from that entire sector. It's like, so essentially the whole automotive service, especially for like American-made cars, they're not really American anymore. Yeah. Actually, the most American-made cars are actually foreign-made cars now because they have the factories over here building them and then shipping them out.
Honda and
Honda.
Hyundai.
There's a massive Kia plant that's in South Georgia.
Yeah, the Porsche factory. Did you see the Porsche factory that they built on, was that 75?
Mm-hmm.
It has like a racing track on the top of the building.
Yeah.
That's just a fucking dick wavy thing.
Yeah.
We put our racing track on top of the building.
Well, like Mercedes has like a massive one that's out towards Tuscaloosa.
Yeah.
Like on the other side of Birmingham.
And that's a German vehicle, isn't
it?
Yeah.
So, but it just kind of goes to show you, it's like, technically, if you wanted to like support American-made cars, you would purchase cars that are actually built here in America, which are not.
Well, it depends on who it is you're trying to support. Are you trying to support the company or the worker?
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I guess it would depend. It's like, where do you want your money to go to, and to what Americans do you want your money to go to?
Yeah, which Americans, yeah.
Yeah, so if you want your money to go to, like, corporate America, like CEOs and shit, then, yeah, you can buy American-made vehicles, quote-unquote American-made. But if you would like for the money to go into the pockets of probably, like, people that are on the factory floor, it's like, then you'd probably be better off purchasing, like, a foreign-made car.
Yeah, that's built here.
That's built here.
Yeah. I mean, we saw what happened to Detroit when the automotive industry moved out of there.
I mean, it's the same thing with the steel industry once it left.
Once
it left like Pittsburgh and like the areas up there.
That's the crazy thing is like if you built, you know, how many times does it happen in Appalachia?
Oh yeah,
with the coal industry.
Yeah,
like all through like Virginia and places like that. If you build your entire town around this one trade, when that trade leaves, you have a town with no money.
Right.
And then what happens? People.
That's the same thing that happened with Gary, Indiana. That was a massive steel town.
Yeah.
And then it just fucking fell apart when that industry left.
One of our listeners, Steven, is a big fan of the podcast. Shout out, Steven. He works in a steel mill near Gary, Indiana.
Really?
So I'm sure he could tell us all about that.
Dumb.
But, I mean, it's fucking scary to think, like, you know, what was it? Was it Amazon that was wanting to build its own town?
Yeah. Was it Amazon?
Was it Amazon or was it Tesla?
I think it was Tesla.
It might have been Tesla.
Yeah, Tesla.
Yeah. I wouldn't.
No.
I would not do that.
It's gone bad too many times. Like in Hershey. Like they tried that in Hershey with the factory up there.
Yeah.
And it's just not a good idea. It's people have tried it and it never works out.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's so concerning that our nation has moved so far away from like like production industry, like actually producing goods.
Yeah, we don't make anything.
To like a service industry. Like I was reading.
All we do is complain about how there's no black people in Disney movies.
Like I was reading something the other day that was stating that starting in the year 2023 that there will no longer be there are no longer going to be any jobs, any new jobs that would be like creating like a product, like production industry. Yeah. It's all going to be service related.
Wow. That's unsustainable.
It's unsustainable, and I don't understand why it is that like more people are not like, what the fuck are we doing?
Yeah, why are we like somewhat? Why don't we make anything here?
Right.
Like if something happens, if people stop sending us shit.
Well, I mean, we have like all these natural resources that like everybody like refuses to tap, and I just don't understand. It doesn't make any sense as to why.
Yeah.
Because it used to be that people like held in high regard like American made products.
Yeah.
Like American steel, like all this, you know. But, like, that doesn't happen anymore. I mean, there are, like, some small companies that, like, they understand, like, that's kind of, like, what they use to differentiate themselves, like, from the competition. It's like, this is American-made. When, like, we try to, like, source as much, like, raw material American-made as possible. But, I mean, there's only so far you can go with that. Yeah. But as far as, like, actually producing the product, like, American-made products.
You know, it's like with the coal. That I was talking about, like in Appalachia or whatever. They didn't run out of coal.
No.
There's still tons and tons, and there's plenty of coal left in that area. It's just the companies found that it was cheaper to just like ship ship coal in from fucking overseas somewhere.
Yeah, than it was to
pay people here to dig it out of the fucking ground. And all the people who lived over there just fucking...
started getting on pills.
Turned into fucking ghost town. Yeah.
I mean... The craziest thing to me is like how people are so upset or so concentrated on like the whole climate crisis where they're like, oh, we can't burn coal and everything. Like it's bad for the environment. And it's like, yeah, be like for the most part, coal is not great to be thrown up in the air like that. It's like, but if you bring up like nuclear power, people like freak the fuck out. Yeah. Like we haven't made any like leaps and bounds in that technology since the 1950s when Chernobyl was built with a glaring issue that everybody understood what was going
to
happen.
Well, they just built it because it was cheaper to build it that way.
Right.
You know, if it weren't for Chernobyl, I think most everybody would be on nuclear.
Right.
It would be pretty much everywhere.
I think France, like their entire country is run off nuclear power.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you don't even have to have it where it's, like, depleted uranium or anything like that. Like, you could...
there's all kinds of alternatives.
Yeah, you have, like, there's, like, molten salt reactors that don't put out hardly as much, like, nuclear waste.
It just means nuclear reaction.
Right.
To make water hot.
Right.
That's all it does.
Right.
Like, we've said it before, like, every, like, power plant, regardless of what it's doing, is it's burning a fuel to boil water to create steam.
Right.
They all do the same thing. It's just about how they do it.
Right.
Yeah. You know, if we could do it without having to dump millions of tons of CO2 into the atmosphere.
That'd be great.
That would be awesome. Let's do it that way.
Well, I mean, just the technology is not there yet in order for us to reliably source, like, wind power and solar power. It just, it's not there.
Yeah.
You can't collect enough of it yet.
It's really irritating, too, especially with solar. Because the fucking sun is like... we can't suck any more power out of it. It's just we get what it gives.
Yeah.
And it'll, we'll be there. Well, I mean, it's going to outlast us.
No.
Like, there'll be one human left, and like, they'll be staring at the sun when they die.
Right.
Like, it's really irritating that there's just no good way to harness it.
Right.
You know? Unless we build a Dyson sphere. But we're really far away from that.
Yeah.
Hey, I love reading about, like, shit like that, like the superstructures or whatever.
No.
For anybody who doesn't know, a Dyson sphere is a big thing you build around the sun to suck all the energy out of it. Who is it that somebody had built, submitted a patent for one?
Oh, really?
Yeah, like somebody like, I don't know, they had like, it was something like 500,000 pages of engineering manuals that they wrote in order to build a Dyson sphere.
Without like all theoretical physics that they use to,
I don't know. I don't know. Like, you have to be shooting in the dark a lot here, right? Like,
imagine working at the patent office. You get that, you're like, oh fuck.
Oh good god.
I'm gonna have to read all this.
Yeah.
He just like goes through, and it's like all these pictures of like cocks in there. Like, I see what this is.
Okay, I got you. Well, before we run out too much time, we actually have a Super Cringe Thursday post we need to we need to discuss. So for anybody who didn't see it, this week's Super Cringe Thursday post was a Cringetopia Remastered.
Yeah, Cringetopia Remastered.
It is a man and a woman, and they are lip-syncing to some fucking song that's like, if I lick it, it's mine. If I bite it, it's gross. Yeah, it's gross. And it's, you know, these two, the idea here is that they're trying to make this TikTok in a way that they're saying, hey, hands off my woman or hands off my man.
I don't think you have to worry about it.
Yeah. And I'm just like, you know, I don't think you guys, I don't think you needed to make this TikTok.
Have a problem there.
I don't think you have any worries.
Yeah. You're dating Gilbert Grape's mama.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah, what is that called? A Mad Eye Mooney? And he's got like one crazy wide eye, and then like a normal like closed eye. Like he just always looked very, very skeptical.
Yeah, it's so crazy because I watched that. I'm like, I can smell this video.
Yeah, I could too. Yeah, it smelled like BO and alcohol.
Yeah, and like like
marble reds, yeah. Cowboy killers. You know, there's a lot of I've seen a lot of videos like that where it's these two
not conventionally
attractive people who are making these videos like, you know, she's mine or like he's mine or whatever, and it's like here's my theory about why it's so many like that. Is because they never run into a situation where somebody is vying for their affection. Yeah. So they have to create that.
Right.
And then they have to create a fake situation in which they can then say, hey, you're not allowed to touch my significant other over here.
This is like
my significantly sized other here.
Because if they did that in public, if somebody would be like, they'd be like, excuse what?
What?
He's like, yeah, hands off my woman. It's like, sir, I'm with my family trying to eat pizza.
Like, he walks over to your table. I've seen you looking over there, Darlene. Well, like, yeah, how could you miss her? I don't have any problem with anybody making the making their little videos or whatever, but like, you know, as like we've said 100 times. On the podcast,
if you stick it out there.
If you post it in public, I mean,
it's free game.
You're open to critique.
I saw a pretty crazy video earlier today where it was a lady who was at the club.
The club?
Yeah, the club TM. And she was urinating into a glass on the dance floor. Like there was somebody's like filming like over her shoulder.
Yeah.
Like, and so she's like leaned up against this rail, this like where the dance floor is at. And she's like got the cup and you see like liquid like going all over the floor and she fills the cup up. Like it's a pint sized glass.
Yeah.
And then she just like takes and like kind of reaches back around and like sits it on this table.
Like behind her?
Yeah. Behind her. And so the person filming, she's like trying to walk away. Person filming grabs it and throws it on her back.
Oh.
It's like, y'all are a bunch of fucking animals.
A fucking bunch of degenerates throwing piss on each other in here.
It's like, ugh. I'm so glad that was like a phase of my life that I just skipped. I was like,
the whole club thing.
I have no interest in going and... Like, you work so hard during the week to make the money that you do make, and then you go to this house of ill repute, and you just piss it away, literally,
into a cup. It's just loud and hot, and
you're hoping to hook up with somebody who's been snorting cocaine in the bathroom,
and they're also all hot and sweaty, Now I think I'd rather just stay home.
Yeah, and then everybody's trying to fight one another.
Yeah. Someone gets shot in the parking lot.
It's not a good time.
You just can't get a bunch of young people together. You can't do it.
No.
Something bad's going to happen.
Yeah, something bad is going to... Well, something bad is going to happen because, like...
Because of young men.
Because,
let's be honest.
Well, I mean, the women are partially at fault here as well, too, because most of the time they're the ones egging it on.
Yeah.
Like, it's like most of the time, like, the women you meet in the club TM are not the ladies that you want to bring home to your mother.
No. You don't want to take them to the altar.
Yeah, the altar TM.
It's like, you ever seen that like Simpsons meme where it's like they're all standing on a boat. There's like two monkeys fighting, and there's like some dudes standing around like cheering it on. That's exactly what it's like. Like young men are like the little monkeys, and like women are like the ones cheering it on. Dance for me, vibe for my affection. Unless you know, it was a situation where somebody like, you know, was like got all up in Mary's face or like was threatening her or something like that. I can't think of very many reasons why I would ever get into a physical altercation on behalf of a woman.
No.
Like, I would do it to defend my wife, absolutely.
No.
But like, if she wasn't my wife and I was trying to get her to like me,
no.
I'm not fighting somebody for it.
No.
Like, no.
No, I'm obviously in the wrong place.
Yeah, if you're the kind of person who expects me to do that, then I don't want to get with you.
It's like, you put me in this situation to begin with, so why am I, you know, you're partly to blame here.
What if this person's a psychopath?
Exactly.
What if they have, like, an AIDS needle in their pocket, and they're, like, jabbing it in my ass, like, while I'm trying to run away? Like, they're running behind me, stabbing me with it.
Yeah, I just don't. The quality of individual that you're going to find in that situation is probably not the best.
No, I would say not. There was the AIDS needle thing reminded me, like, you know, every now and then there's like a thing that'll start circulating on Facebook of like, you know, you need to watch out for this thing. People are doing this thing now.
Yeah.
And there was one where it was people are taping hyperdermic needle tips underneath gas pump handles.
Oh, yeah.
That way when you go to pump your gas, it stabs you in the hand.
Mm.
And you get, you know, AIDS.
You get AIDS.
And it's like, the crazy thing is, it's like, you know, could that happen? Yes, that could happen. But also, a meteor could fall on you.
Right.
That could also happen.
And if it was to happen, I would just sue the fuck out of the gas station.
Yeah.
And I would never have to worry about money ever again in my life.
Or the fact that I have AIDS. It would be completely negligible.
Right. Because I'd be swimming in money.
Like Magic Johnson hasn't died yet, so.
I think we're okay.
Wasn't there like a South Park episode where they like the cure to AIDS was like to inject actual cash into people?
He's just like blending it up in the blender.
God, there was another one that was circulating for a while there. It was called Momo. You remember Momo? I don't know if you remember that. It was a picture of like a woman's face. It was like a very long face with like a big Cheshire cat grin and like these wide eyes and like stringy black hair.
No.
It was a picture of like an art installation.
Yeah.
And people started passing it around as like a creepypasta kind of thing.
Yeah.
But then it hit Facebook and like all the single moms started taking it way too seriously.
Yeah.
And they're like, you're saying kids are seeing this and they're like trying to kill themselves and they're blah, 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 and they're doing this. And I remember somebody that I know, I know, right? Somebody that I know personally posted, all you other mamas need to watch out because Momo has officially hacked into Fortnite.
You're like what am I reading?
What do you think that means? Yeah. What do you think that means? Like, hacked into Fortnite. Yeah.
It's like just because you watched The Ring when you were younger, like don't put that on your kids.
Yeah, don't conflate this with reality, please. You know, you're doing nobody any favors by doing this. Momo hacked into Fortnite. What does that mean?
It's like, can we be at the bottom of the screen? Yeah.
Or like it's playing Fortnite. Yeah. Like you just come across a character named Momo. Like, it's so fucking stupid.
Well, it's like, I don't, and we've talked about it before. It's like, I just think that social media just brings out the worst in people.
It does.
And
in every kind of direction, like any kind of worst you can be, yeah, it brings that out.
It's like anytime like I see somebody that makes like a stupid comment online, and like I feel like compelled to be like, you're a dumbass.
Yeah, you're stupid.
Get off the internet.
Yeah.
Like most of the time I'm like I'll think about it for a second and I'll just be like, nah.
Just leave it.
It's like, it's just not worth my time.
Yeah.
Like I got 1,000 other things I can go fucking do, so I think I'll just go do those things.
Well, you know, I like to start shit on the internet.
Yeah, well,
I love to one of my favorite things to do. I love doing this. Is I love to go into
just like drop it and leave.
Yes. I fucking love doing that. Just like drop into like some comment section, say something like crazy inflammatory, yeah, and just leave. And like not reply to anyone, yeah, and just let everyone be mad. I'm like asleep in bed. People are just like screaming.
You know, it makes me wonder too. It's like how many people like that you see on the internet, like how many people like are actually people, and how many of those people that are making like inflammatory comments are actually just like, they're like bots. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think the bot situation. The bot situation is really interesting because, you know, it is kind of hard to differentiate.
Yeah. I think there's some pretty telltale signs.
There are. There definitely are. But you know, it's stuff that you have to look into in order to kind of figure it out. And a lot of people aren't going to spend the kind of time it takes to, you know, to figure that out. Like, I mean, there's so many, like, it almost never fails. Like, if you get like a weird comment from somebody or like a message from somebody, you don't know who this person is.
No.
If you go to their like Facebook profile and like you go to their like about page, usually it's like, you know, lives in Myanmar. Or, like, you know, somewhere in Iraq.
No.
You know, like that. And then, like, you check their friends list, and it's like 10,000 brown people. you're like, oh, okay, this is fake. But a lot of people just kind of will take it at face value.
Yeah.
That's what old people get scammed all the time on Facebook. Yeah. Constantly getting scammed on Facebook.
Yeah, it's always crazy to me how forward some of like the people that are trying to scam you are.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, especially like with like very large chested women pictures.
Yes.
It's just like
those are so fucking funny.
It's just like some lady like laying down looking at the camera with like her tits out, and then it's all like, and then they just type in like a stupid like starter like, hello, I noticed your page.
Yeah.
And then they're hoping.
Love your smile.
Yeah. And they're hoping that somebody would be like, I'm like, oh, I really like your tits.
Yeah.
Or like some stupid shit, like thinking that they're, you know, they're going to get some booby pictures or something. And then they're like, and they'll always do the thing where they're like, oh, they're like, I am really sad. Like, is there any way that you could give me some money?
Yeah.
Like, I am in a hard place.
Yeah. You see those a lot on, like, local groups.
Yeah.
Like, there's a group for our hometown that I'm in on Facebook. And I see posts in there all the time that are, like, people, like, begging for money or whatever. And they almost always get something. And no matter how many times the moderators are like, guys, do not give money to these people.
Yeah.
Do not give them your information. They're scams.
Right.
There's one, a real famous one is like the lost dog scam thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because what they'll do is they'll make this page. They'll get a picture of a dog. They'll say, hey, I lost my dog off of such and such road. And it's so easy for them to just Google a road in the town you live in.
Right.
And say, I lost my dog off this road. And, you know, please help me find it. And they'll get, you know, upwards of thousands of shares. Like when Trixie went missing,
mm-hmm,
that post I made to get people to look out for, I think it got like 500 shares or something like that. Yeah. 500 people shared it. So it's very easy to get that kind of rolling. Yeah. So once they get this page shared so many times, and they say, they have all these engagements with the page or whatever, they can take those like analytics and sell them to someone.
Right.
And then all of a sudden you have an ad for like, I don't know, asshole cream appearing. That you, like, when did I like this? Yeah. And it happens constantly. My favorite ones are when you get a Facebook, like a friend request from some, like you said, a large chested individual where their profile picture is like just their tits.
No. It's just like, there's no face. Yeah. It's just cleavage.
Yeah. They just, they end right here at the clavicle. If you go to those pages and like look at the comments on the profile picture, they are so fucking funny.
Yeah. Some of them are pretty vile.
Yeah, they are. Some of them are pretty rough, but like the funniest ones are like the old white dudes who like
just like the picture like
this. Yeah, who have the picture like looking down at the camera. Like, how do you work this damn thing? Like that picture. And it's always like, so they're saying like some crazy out of pocket shit like, damn, would love to suck those.
Yeah.
And like you go to their page and it's like a picture of him like with his grandkids. And you're like, he doesn't understand that everyone can see what he's doing, but everybody's too polite to tell him that they're seeing it. So he's just going to continue doing this.
It's like, sir, you have a picture with your wife as your profile picture.
Oh, man. He just keeps subjecting his family to all his perversion. And then his wife will see it. She doesn't understand what it is. Yeah. She'll be like, my husband's Facebook page got hacked. Was commenting on some booby picture. And he's like, I told you I don't trust some damn iPhones. And
oh, God.
I saw this thing where someone had printed out a picture of like her kid and their grandkids or whatever.
No.
And it had like a 20% opacity like volume control thing on it. Yeah. Because clearly what they had done was taken a screenshot of the picture and printed it out, but they accidentally hit the volume button first. And it's just like they don't notice these things.
No.
The old people just don't notice these things.
Yeah, it's just so I find it hilarious, like, when I see...
What kind of blunders are we going to make 20 years from now?
I'm just not going to... I just won't... I won't do any of it. Yeah. I just be like, no, I'm out. I'm done. Yeah. I'm out.
My kids would be like, Dad, we can see your dick right now.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, how? I'm sitting on the couch. Like, well, you're supposed to do it this way.
They're going to be like, when are you going to... When are you going to put the thing in your fucking head? It's like, I'm not.
I'm not.
I'm not.
Nothing's going in my head.
Nothing's going in my fucking head.
Like, you got to plug it up when you go to bed.
Like, oh, make sure I charge my brain.
It's like, sorry, I didn't make it to work on time. I forgot to charge my brain last night. My alarm didn't go off.
He's like asleep, and there's like a Coca-Cola commercial like playing in your dreams. Yeah. You're like, fuck, this one again.
You like wake up, you're like, I really want a Coke.
Yeah.
Want a Coke real bad.
It's like unskippable.
Yeah. Wasn't there a Futurama episode about that, about getting ads in your sleep?
I don't remember which one that was.
I think there was. I think it was, matter of fact, I think it was their iPhone parody one. Would you know, it's, you know, it was very on the nose. It was literally a phone that goes in your eye and it projects everything out in front of your face. And the guy was like, he's like, the way we install it or whatever, and like he sticks it in Fry's eye, he like hits it with a hammer. Oh, man. I love when you see comments from Indian guys. Those are the funniest ones.
They are very funny.
Milk truck just arrived. You can't write that shit, man.
Bob and Vagine.
Yeah. Show Bob's.
Bitch lasagna.
Bitch lasagna is... It's so funny that became synonymous for an entire nation just because of one guy. One guy had a very loose grasp on the English language. He was trying to insult someone. Bitch lasagna.
What's the one where it's those two guys that are arguing with one another?
Oh, in the car? Like, yeah, I put an audio clip from that at the end of one of our episodes because we had talked about it. But yeah, it's like, he walks over and he was like, they were like, why? He was like, why didn't you fucking go? And he was like, you fuck you. He's like, oh, fuck me. Fuck you, buddy. Fuck you, buddy. Bloody bastard, bitch. I love that fucking video because it escalates so quickly.
There's so many like funny like Indian like videos online.
Yes.
It's like that one, and there's like, how can she slap?
How can she slap? Oh, man. I don't know if we've ever talked about how can she slap. I'm sure we must have. We should post that as a Super Cringe Thursday because that's just so funny. It's such a fucking funny video.
It's such a classic, like...
It is.
It's such, like, a classic internet video.
It is.
From, like, the olden days.
Yeah. It was a... It was obviously some kind of weird game show, like very sexually charged game show.
Like BDSM show.
Yeah.
Like there's like nobody's wearing a shirt.
Yeah. There was like these three
like
men.
Like a dominatrix lady.
Yeah. There was like these three men standing there and then like a dominatrix lady who was just like insulting them. And she was like, these guys, they have no life in them. She's like, they don't want, or I don't, why should I talk to them or whatever? And one guy was like, maybe we don't want to talk to you actually.
Yeah.
That's what he says. And she goes, well, why don't you fuck off then?
Yeah.
And he goes, you go. I don't know why, but just you go is so fucking funny. And like the way he says it, he just has this smugness on his face. And he's like, gotcha, bitch. You go. And she slaps him in the face. And he smacks the dog piss out of this woman.
No hesitation. No hesitation.
Like immediate counter.
It's so funny because when he slaps the shit out of her, like her hair just
goes in all different directions.
Goes in all different directions. And then like as soon as
she stumbles back like 10 feet.
As soon as like you hear the audible smack, he immediately, he goes, how could you slap?
Yeah. He goes, how could she slap? How could she slap me? He gets fucking butt rushed by like 50 people.
Yeah.
There's like 50 dudes come and restrain him, and the whole time he's going, "How could you slap me?" Like the
I just thought it was so funny. Before anybody came up, he was like, "Oh fuck, what the hell am I doing?"
Yeah, you can see it on his face. He's like already trying to make his case. Oh, my God.
Oh, good.
And then the host is like, how could you slap her, you bastard? They did. He smacked the fuck out of her.
Slapped the shit out of her.
It was one of the best slaps I've ever seen. It's like on par with that subway train one where that dude...
That subway train
one. In the jacket.
Like,
and he didn't even follow through. He hit her and came off of it. You know what I mean?
That slap, because his arms are so fucking long.
Yeah.
I don't know how he missed the poles and everything else inside that subway train, but that came from over on whatever fucking street that they were just on when he slapped her.
He was like, he's like 7 feet tall. He's a tall dude.
Yeah.
So he's got like a 4.5 foot long arm.
And then proceeded to beat the shit out of the other two girls.
Yeah, he beat everybody that came after him. He was just
beating up everyone. Like, maybe y'all should leave that guy alone.
Yeah, he was just, you know, minding his own business. He was well aware of what he was capable of. He did. He smacked the fucking fire out of her. Those videos are so funny. It's funny, too, because, like, this is going to sound weird to say, but I always laugh when I see a video of, like, a woman getting hit. Because they always make the same face afterwards. Like, it's just... It's
shocking
complete
confusion.
And utter shock.
Yeah.
Like, I can't believe I was just held accountable for my actions. It's all, you know, there's so many videos of, like, you know, some woman, like, screaming in a dude's face and, like, pushing him, shoving him, slapping him. And then, like, the moment that he retaliates, she just has his face like...
Right.
You know, like you shot someone in front of her.
Well, I mean, there's also, there's a large difference between, like, like that type of woman as opposed to like the women that like fight in the UFC.
Well, yeah.
Who like the women that like fight in the UFC, like I would imagine most of them are not out there trying to pick fights with people.
No. Probably not. They don't feel like they need to.
Well, it's like most of the guys that fight in the UFC, they're not out there trying to pick fights with people.
Yeah.
Like they're mostly just like want to be left the fuck alone.
Yeah. Unless you're like that one dude who was in that bar.
Oh, yeah. Say,
who was that? Was that Jake Shields?
Was it? He knocked that guy out?
Yeah.
Yeah, either that or War Machine.
Well, War Machine, well, War Machine is, he was a whole, hey, that guy was a basket case. You ever watch that documentary on him? He was insane. He was a literal insane person.
Well, there was, he was a crazy one. There was another one.
Didn't he date a porn star and he beat the shit out of her?
Yeah, beat the shit out of her and I think beat the shit out of her, the guy, out of like the guy that she was having an affair with.
Yeah.
He beat the shit out of her while that guy was in there. He's like, you're next.
Like when I'm done with
her. Yeah, when I'm done with her, I'm going to beat your ass.
What a fucking psycho.
Yeah. He beat the shit out of her and then beat the shit out of him.
You know what? She's culpable a little bit for that because she knew who she was dating. Yeah,
exactly.
And she fucked this guy anyway, knowing what kind of danger she was putting him in.
Well, there was, he was a fucking...
And some girl was like, my boyfriend's a UFC fighter.
Yeah. I'm like, what's his name? And then she's like, War Machine. I'd be like, nope.
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 No, I don't even need to hear the guy's name. He's a professional fighter. I'm not going to fuck his girlfriend.
Well, he was a crazy one. And then there was another one. He was a fucking nutbag, too. He used to do that show, Bully Beatdown.
What was that guy's name?
Jason Mayhem Miller.
Yeah.
I think he got into some trouble.
Yeah.
Like some felony assault charges.
Yeah.
Got brought up on him.
That show was so fake.
Oh, yeah.
That show was so crazy fake. Like, in retrospect, like, these were like, it was like 20-year-old dudes who had a bully.
Right.
Like, no, you don't.
No, you don't. Like, I remember watching one where, like, the guy got in the ring with Andre Orlovsky, and I was I was like, oh no.
Oh, yeah. That crazy Russian motherfucker. Yeah.
I was like, uh-oh.
He beat the dog shit out of that dude.
He beat the fly shit out of that guy.
Orlovsky, I mean, like, that dude's like...
That dude...
He's like 6'6".
Yeah, he was 6'6".
And like 290 pounds.
Yeah, he's a big guy. He was like a two-time UFC, like, heavyweight champion.
Yeah.
Like, very well...
For good reason.
Very well respected.
Yeah. I'm not getting in the fucking ring with that dude.
No.
No.
This guy's name is the Pitbull.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not.
I'm pretty sure they only got like $20,000.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. It's not worth $20,000 to get in the ring with this.
Well, congratulations. Your hospital bills are $21,000.
You can use that $20,000 to repair your orbital socket. Was this somebody got in the ring with one of those fighters and the fighter like kicked the dude in the head? Like, they weren't supposed to.
Oh,
the bully,
yeah.
The quote-unquote bully, like, landed a shot on the guy, and it pissed the fighter off.
Yeah, I know which one you're talking about.
And he, like, kicked him in the head, like, roundhouse kicked the guy in the
head.
Yeah,
it was some Australian guy, and, like, knocked that dude the fuck out.
Yeah.
And he was like, I don't give a fuck. I'm knocking you out now.
Yeah. Because the amateurs, they're wearing, like,
headgear
and pads and stuff. But, I mean, a kick to the side of the head from a trained UFC fighter, it doesn't matter if you're wearing a fucking football helmet. It's going to suck.
It'd be like, you imagine, like, getting kicked in the head by, like, Miracle Crocop.
Oh, God.
Yeah, you'd just be dead in the ring. Then he'd be like, well, just go ahead and stick him in the bag and take him away.
He'd just kick your head off. Like, your body was...
Like, catches in the crowd. Like, yeah!
Like a fucking foul ball. Who was it that Crocop was fighting that one time and punched him in the head once and, like, shattered his whole skull?
Bob Sapp.
Bob Sapp,
Sapp. He broke his fucking orbital bone, like, cracked it in half.
With one punch.
Yeah. Like, that guy, that, like, if you ever watch, like, some of, like, his highlight reels.
Scary.
Like, him, like, kicking people.
Yeah.
It's like there was like people like would they'd be blocking. I remember I watched one where the guy was blocking and he hit him so hard. He kicked him so fucking hard that the guy punched himself in the face and knocked himself out. Like,
just the amount of force that man could put out.
Well, I think
unreal.
he was Secret Service in Croatia. Like this dude was like he actually killed people.
probably by kicking them.
Yeah. like he has probably murdered many
people. He
probably
assassinated somebody by kicking them. Like, he snuck into, like, their, like, estate.
Yeah.
And, like rappelled down the ceiling and, like, kicked him in the head.
Stomps the heel of his boot and a knife shoots out the end of it. He, like, sticks it in their neck.
I just imagine him, like, rappelling down from the ceiling like Spider-Man. And it's just, like, behind the guy and just... He just escapes.
Yeah, that guy was a fucking nutbag. Like, he was fucking scary to watch. Especially, like, when you have a fighter that is, like, well known to knock someone out.
Yeah.
Like, in a very particular style. Mm-hmm. It's like, and there's nothing you can do to stop it.
He keeps knocking people out who are guarding.
Yeah. It's like the whole time you're just like, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
Like, when is it going to happen?
Yeah, it's going to happen, but
like,
when?
It's going to happen.
It's the anticipation.
Like, right. It was like when Brock, like before Brock got diverticulitis and like it fucked his intestines up.
Yeah.
Like, he was just mowing through people.
You just couldn't, you couldn't stand up to him.
No.
He was just a big mountain of a man that would charge you from the other side of the ring.
It's like trying to fight a fucking silverback gorilla. What are you going to do?
Yeah, nothing.
Yeah.
You can do nothing.
It's like he would cut down to 265 and then balloon back up to 300 pounds.
Yeah.
Like, by the time the fight got there.
All muscle, too.
Yeah. So it's like you get in the ring. It's like when he fought Randy Couture.
Yeah.
And Randy Couture was a really good fighter.
Yeah.
Like, in the Hall of Fame. Like, that's how good this fucking guy was.
At a certain point, it stops mattering.
And Brock hit him in the head and hit him so fucking hard that he rolled back. And by the time he had rolled back and was on his back, Brock was in the air like this and, like, just jumped on top of him and just put both of his hands in his chest. So it was holding his hands down and beating him in the head with the other hand.
My God.
Like, what are you supposed to do with that?
Lose.
That's the thing. Well, I can't do anything.
Yeah. Thanks for coming out, everybody. I had a great time. Yeah.
This would be like, it'd be like me trying to fight like a 5-year-old. like, I'm about to fuck you up.
Yeah. You're going down, kid. What was that guy said in that video I sent you, that golf guy? He said, you want to test God? What'd he say? He said, you want to test God? He's like, I'm right here, shit stack, or something like that. It's this video of this dude, like, having a freak out on the golf course, and he's yelling at somebody off camera, and then, like, it gets to a point where he pulls his, like, polo shirt off, and he's just got, like, this unimpressive, like, dad bod.
Yeah, it's not.
And he flexes like this, and he's, like, screaming, he's going nuts.
It's like, there's, like, all the veins in his neck.
To his credit, though, when he did that, those people left.
Yeah, I mean.
So.
It works.
He won. He's the winner.
but at what cost?
A lot of his dignity. A good portion of it. It's so funny. It's so funny, that video, because he pulls his shirt off and he looks down at himself.
Yeah.
Like, this is
the peak performance. Peak performance.
He's just got this beer gut.
Yeah.
Like these man boobs.
Yeah, it's just not. I was watching, there's a subreddit that I like to go to. It's called Fight Porn.
Yeah, I like Fight Porn.
There's a particular video where there's these two guys that are getting ready to fight, and one dude goes to pull his hoodie off, and as he's pulling his hoodie off, this dude just fucking rocks him in the head, and then he, like, stumbles backwards and gets his hoodie off, and then he goes to take his shirt off, and while he's got his shirt up over the head, the dude just punches him in the fucking head again, and the kid, dude just passes out on the ground. It's like, you fucking moron.
Why'd you spend all that time getting undressed and not fighting?
Could you imagine, like, trying to fight someone and, like, the first thing they do is take their pants off?
Yeah, they, like, kick their shoes off.
Yeah, like, kick
start their... unbuttoning their pants.
Yeah. So all they're wearing is just, like, a t-shirt and their cock is flopping around.
Like Winnie the Pooh style? I'll tell you one thing, I don't want this guy to mount me. I'm not going to grapple with him, that's for damn sure.
I think that would be...
How scary would it be if he tripped you up and you fell down, just knowing that he's standing over you with his cock out? You, like, feel it on, like, the back of your shirt.
He just got, like, this raging hard on. Just like, ah!
Like, look, man, you win. You win, okay?
He's like, I haven't won yet. I think that would... I would rather fight someone that is totally clothed than someone that has no clothes on.
Yeah, absolutely. Even if I knew I could beat that person.
Yeah, it's its own, you know, the stakes are too high at this
point. Way too high. Yeah. Like, we might trip and fall down.
Yeah.
And, like, I land face first on his junk.
Yeah, just not.
And then I lost. Regardless of what the outcome of this fight is, yeah, I lost.
I could decapitate this guy at this point, and I still have lost. Then there's no recovering.
He's like, feel it on my lips when I go to bed that night. Well, I think that's about all we got time for today, everybody. It's hot as fuck in this room. It is sweltering in here. So we're going to get out of here. So once again, as always, thank you everybody for listening. This is episode 81, by the way. We forgot to bring up that last episode was episode 80.
Yes.
Which is insane to think that we put out 80 episodes and people are still listening to us. So for those of you who are still listening, thank you very much for listening. We do appreciate it. If you're new here, hello and welcome. This is what the podcast is. I do have, and I'm sorry that I need to read. I'm glad that I remembered. We'll do it right quick before we get out of here. So on the last episode, we said that Dad lived in a house that had dirt floors.
Ah.
Dad said, correction, we didn't have a dirt floor. You could see the dirt between the floorboards.
Oh, okay. There we go.
So sorry, Dad. Here's the soundbite.
We're sorry.
And there you go. So if we have anything else that we were wrong about, anything that you'd like us to talk about, make sure you write into the podcast and you let us know. You can message us on Facebook or you can email us at thiccboypodcast@gmail.com. Do you have anything you'd like to close with?
Nope. Just thank you for the continued support. We really do appreciate it. Like Gary said, if you get a chance, make sure that you leave a like, a rating, or a review on your preferred podcast platform. If we're not where you prefer to watch or listen to your podcast, let us know, and we'll figure out how to get it where it is that you can listen to it there.
Some of the more astute listeners may have noticed that you haven't heard me vaping in the past couple of episodes. That's because I quit vaping. So, round of applause for me. I made one good decision this year. All right, everybody. That's the podcast. Thank you and goodbye. Truck just arrived.